प्रीकिबास स्वागत है आपका। संसद परिसर में राज्यसभा के नए सांसदों के लिए आयोजित दो दिन का विषय बोध यानी कि ओरिएंटेशन कार्यक्रम चल रहा है। कार्यक्रम में अब कानूनविद और पूर्व सांसद फाली एस नरीमन राजनीति में आचार संहिता पर भाषण दे रहे हैं। आइए आपको सीधे ले चलते हैं संसद परिसर।
सदन में, राज्यसभा में या लोकसभा में
वन थिंग इन कॉमन, नॉट ओनली इन आवर कंट्री बट ऑल अराउंड द वर्ल्ड, वी आर ऑल हेल्ड इन लो पब्लिक एस्टीम। दिस इज सिंपली बिकॉज in public perception neither of us is able to produce tangible results. We lawyers, with our prolix and seemingly never ending arguments in court, have done little to eradicate the scourge of inordinate delays in legal proceedings. And in recent times, members of parliament, both houses, have been seen by the masses as not having contributed much to relieving the innumerable trials and tribulations of we the people. Those first three stirring words with which our constitution begins. The truth is that we the people are dissatisfied not only with the performance of those who plead in court like ourselves, but also of those like you who attend, and quite often do not attend, Parliament as well. There's a close race today as to which is lower in public esteem, the lawyer or the lawgiver. So sadly, both for lawyers and for members of Parliament, ethics in politics as in the law is at a very low ebb. But I have a theory which I have for long believed in, that a large part of the disruption of proceedings in Parliament, about which the people outside are so deeply concerned, could perhaps be avoided with a simple experiment. And I am putting forward this theory, as I have before, hoping it will find some support. And my view is as follows. If while conducting business in each of the Houses of Parliament, the Honourable Speaker or the Honourable Chairperson or their deputies just refuse to adjourn proceedings whenever there are altercations or attempted disruptions in either the Lok Sabha or the Rajya Sabha, and remain seated in their chair, conditions might improve. But so far, most regrettably, such a move has not even been attempted. My suggestion is that when members rush to the well of the House, sometimes with placards — I've never seen placards in my time, but this is something new, some new thing keeps coming up — and will not allow a bill to be passed or a matter to be discussed, howsoever important, with all parties across the political spectrum, then if only the presiding officer keeps his or her cool and remains seated in the chair for which he or she will not move for minutes together or hours together, MPs who come shouting, gesticulating down the aisle will have at some time or the other, either because they get hoarse or they get fed up, to stop their activities, at which point proceedings will hopefully resume. And there is a reason behind this theory. As long as the Please remember this always. As long as the Speaker or the Chairperson is in the chair, irrespective of whoever it is, the House remains in session. That's a very, very important circumstance. The House remains in session. Also, the listed business of either body at some time or the other gets transacted. And it is only when the chair is vacant and the House is adjourned, whether for a few minutes, few hours or for the day, that little or no work gets transacted. Therefore, my unsolicited but most respectful advice to the chair in each of the Houses of Parliament is that occupants stick to their seats, whatever the disturbance or provocation. But I must frankly admit that when this suggestion was mentioned by me to a very high and distinguished personage who shall remain nameless, that personage told me, somewhat weakly though politely, that it was a good idea, which made me give me the impression that he wasn't convinced. Just like Gandhiji's enthusiastic and terse response to a British journalist's query before India got independence in August 47. Journalist asked him what was the great man's view about modern civilization. And Gandhiji responded, well, it's a good idea. I suggest my proposal of the chair sticking steadfast to the chair should not be just treated as a good idea, but one that should be implemented. Try it. It might work only because all other methods so far of making proceedings go on in Parliament do not appear to have been successful. One other thing, and this I please request you all to bear in mind. There is such a thing as the image of the House. It's a very important thing. Not only your image as a member, but the image of the House as a whole. Like the image of the Supreme Court, not the image of a particular judge of the Supreme Court, but of the image of the court, like that. These are institutions which have built around them an image which requires to be maintained. I tell you this because when I was a member of this House 10 years ago, a parliamentary delegation from Jordan, which doesn't have any parliament, it has a king, was witnessing proceedings in this House, up next door. And the deputy chairman, in a very fine welcome speech, expressed a hope that they would all learn something of our parliamentary system. So we all rose and we all applauded them and they all sat down and so on. They were there for 10 minutes. The only thing they heard from our parliamentary system was that there was continuous disruption. No one could hear what anyone else was saying. A very poor exhibition of our parliamentary democracy to the world. I think they went back and said, thank God we have got a monarchy and no democracy. And I felt personally ashamed of this because it is very, very important. The image of the House is important. All of you have to maintain that image. Doesn't matter what you think of one another, makes no difference. But when somebody else comes in and they all sit, there's a special space for them in the House, and they all come in and the Speaker welcomes them or the Chair welcomes them, and then for God's sake, you have to be very, very careful. You have to make it appear at least that this House is functioning. They must not go back and think that, oh my God, these fellows in India are hopeless. They don't even know how to conduct any proceedings in any House. This is a very important. Therefore, the image of the House is a very vital thing on this ethical problem. The other important thing that I'd like to bring to your notice as to do's and don'ts, you all have read the rules and I don't wish to say anything about them. You read them again, read them backwards, read them forward. You know what to do, you know what not to do, etc. But the most important thing I wish to emphasize is that members of Parliament, both houses, must be conscious of the fact, and this I unfortunately find they are not conscious, that being a member of Parliament is one of the greatest privileges you can have in this country. It really is. Whether you are nominated, whether you are elected, to every new member I can tell him or her that at least 1,000 other citizens would have been as well qualified, as capable as you, willing to fill your seat. Don't you think so?
Yeah,
exactly. It is a humbling thought, I agree, it's humbling. But it must be kept in mind. Participating in proceedings in the House, even when certain MPs are silent and do not speak is itself a great experience. All members of Parliament must therefore be conscious of the significantly important fact that there are altogether just 790 odd members in both houses, and you represent more than 1 billion people outside. So expectations are very great. People expect you to do something. Even sit in the house is something. Don't speak if you don't want to, or you cannot, or you will not speak. But at least give the impression that you are contributing to something. And that's a very, very important contribution for all of you. And it's a great privilege and a great responsibility. Members of Parliament may not remember the oath they took when they first entered, but each of the elected members have to swear, amongst other things, "I will faithfully discharge the duty upon which I am about to enter." You don't faithfully discharge your duty if you sign the register outside the hall and walk away. That's not part of your duty. As it is, the house doesn't sit 365 days. It sits for a very, very minimal period of time. In my time, it used to sit for about 90 days. Now it's even 60 or 70 in the whole year. So you can afford to contribute that much of your time. Playing truant, I agree, is not prohibited, but it is not expected. It is simply not ethical and not honest. No work, no pay was the bill I had introduced way back in September 2004 as a private member's bill during my stint in the Rajya Sabha. Every sitting member applauded it and said, "Oh yes, a very good thing." But my piece of legislation went the way of most private members' bills. It never saw the light of day as an enactment, because only Friday afternoons are reserved for private members' bills during each week of the Parliament session. My term of office ended, and the bill which it did get introduced was not listed for discussion thereafter. And on my retirement in 2005, after 6 long years, the bill lapsed. Unlike a government bill, it does not lapse because the mover, the minister, is no longer in office. A private member's bill always lapses with the private member ceasing to be a member of the House. So, ladies and gentlemen, my first attempt to inject some ethics into politics was, I must confess, a total failure. To become a member of Parliament and having the prefix honorable before one's name does mean a lot. It is a device deliberately adopted, and it is to keep you on the right path. And keeping you on the right path is what ethics is all about. If MPs have the appellation honorable, they must be seen to be honorable in all that they do or all that they don't do, whether within the house or outside. That's the cross you have to bear. Our founding fathers deliberately gave MPs the prefix honorable, and try as they might, they cannot get rid of it. It is like a halter around your neck. It gets removed only when you are no longer an MP. So long as an individual is an MP, the prefix sticks to him or her, which means he or she must deserve it and live up to it. I have often wondered, and I say this with great respect, how honorable it is for a sitting member to be seen advertising some commercial product or the other, except perhaps for charitable causes. And I would humbly advise and plead with members of Parliament not to be tempted with this tinsel publicity. It somehow demeans you, at least in my estimation. I don't know what the minister said, thinks, but it sort of somehow demeans. You say, "Here's a great member of Parliament," and suddenly you are advertising some soap or some something or the other on television, not for the heck of it, not for because you are so charitably minded, but for filthy lucre, like we lawyers say. So we the people, I think, learn by example of our leaders, not by precepts. How can MPs become truly honorable and remain honorable during their term of office? I have some answers. First, by not entering into the will of the House to disturb the proceedings. If a sufficient number of members of Parliament, and there are quite a few here, belonging to a particular party, I don't know what party you belong to, whichever party, together convince the leaders of the party that this should not happen, then in the not too distant future, it will not happen. Second, by not doing anything to prevent proceedings from going on. If MPs do have to walk out as a group with other members of their party, you have a right. That's a fundamental right. You are making a statement. It's a part of your free speech. You can do so, but without too much disturbance as a mark of protest against some event or activity. But, and this is a very important but, they must come back in 10 or 15 minutes to participate again in the proceedings of the House, not sit outside in the hall and have tea and coffee and have a chat. That's really parliamentary proceeding. And somehow, I think we made a great mistake in our constitution by providing for ordinances to be passed. You will find in England, they have no provision for an ordinance. Ministers can't make a law. Only Parliament can make a law. So the House is almost continuously in session. Almost continuously in session. And that's a very, very important thing. And it is they who make laws, not the executive who makes the law and then you approve it or you disapprove it. Very rarely it's disapproved. Generally it's approved. So the emphasis is the wrong emphasis. People who make laws are and should be members of Parliament, not the executive. If the executive is going to make the law as well as administer it, then there's no need for having a parliament at all. So participating in proceedings of the House and not walking out is why all of you are elected. That is why you are also paid. The only reason why you are called honorable is because the Constitution regards that you are taking part in making laws as an honorable pursuit. Third, MPs don't remain honorable, as I said before, by merely signing the book, earning their hafta for the day and walking out. That is positively dishonorable. And believe me, there is pleasure in every job done, and that includes attending sessions. When new MPs keenly participate in the proceedings and keep their ears and eyes open, they may get an opportunity to speak. If due to pressures of parliamentary time, some MPs don't get such an opportunity to speak, they can impress upon their party leaders to nominate them to one or more of the innumerable parliamentary committees which meet regularly, especially when Parliament is not in session. In my time in the Rajya Sabha, almost every MP had some responsibility assigned to him or her. I don't know whether it's the same thing today, as a member of one committee or another. And as the committee is a smaller body than the House, there would be more opportunities for MPs to make meaningful contributions in various fields. When MPs demit office before every general election in the Lok Sabha, when their six-year term ends, they should remember that the state still continues to treat you as a very, very special person. You are given a pension which never gets reduced. I retired 12 years ago. My pension keeps getting increased. It's never reduced. I can assure you. Experience shows it keeps getting increased. And after you retire, all your health problems and those of your families are looked after at the exclusive expense of the state, which has a tremendous benefit. Tremendous benefit. Just see the benefits you get. All these factors must prompt each of you to devote a little time and experience whilst functioning as a sitting member. This is a sample of the work ethic in Parliament, which is the best ethic thing in ethics, the work ethic. The consciousness of being a member of Parliament is very important for every member of Parliament. When he or she in his time becomes a minister or some other official, he always desires to excel in performance. I have seen this happening during my term in Parliament. In my sojourn in the Rajya Sabha for 6 long years, I found in one person first, Manivshankar Iyer, Congress MP from Tamil Nadu, not very popular these days, but he was then a minister in the Congress-led UPA government, which came to power in May 2004 and continued in office for 10 years. He was one person, I remember, who spent vast amount of time working on answers to questions. He answered questions in Parliament fully, sometimes too fully, so much so that the chairman, Mr. Shekhawat, would say, "Abhi, bas bahut ho gaya, bahut ho gaya, bahut ho gaya, bait jao, that's all, too much," because he'd go on and on and on. But he was fully prepared, which also reminds me of another aspect of Manivshankar. Not just a fine parliamentarian, but he had a very caustic tongue. His comments were very acerbic. He was, of course, one of the most entertaining of speakers on the floor, but he was at his sarcastic best when in 2005, when someone remarked in the House that late Prime Minister Narasimha Rao, Prime Minister from 91 to 96, he was very fluent and spoke in 10 different languages. True, Manivshankar Iyer's spontaneous response, which he said under his breath, but when Manivshankar said something under his breath, it can be heard all around. He said it was very sad. He could not take a decision in even one of them. Perhaps a little too harsh, considering that Rao's tenure as Prime Minister witnessed the Indian economy grow by leaps and bounds, thanks to liberalization and globalization. But then there is a sequel to Iyer's remark, as there is a sequel to everything. In an excellent book recently published, Half Lion, How P.V. Narasimha Rao Transformed India, by a chap called Vinay Sitapati, I don't know if you browse through it. The author informs us that when the fortunes of Mr. Rao, whom he calls the old Chanakya, were in political decline after May 1996, and he had resigned as president of the Congress, no leader of the party wanted to see him or to condole with him or to have tea with him. And the former prime minister then presciently told a friend, "Yes, yes," he says, "I have been accused of not taking a decision in so many languages and all that. But look, the only decision I took in a hurry was resigning as Congress president, and see what has happened to me as a result." Nobody came to it. So when fate, being remorseless, strikes us, the best of us and the most eloquent of us become hopeless, helpless. Now a bit about myself, because I must preach only by example. When I was first nominated in November 1999 as a member of the Rajya Sabha, I persuaded myself to believe, out of purely selfish motives, that I could attend the session for a couple of hours each day, go back to my active practice of law in the Supreme Court. But I must tell you, I was soon disillusioned, and I realized I could not perform two different duties at two different places on the same day, not at all effectively. I found I was completely dissatisfied with myself. I could do neither of the two jobs effectively. I said one must give up one activity or the other, and the activity I gave up temporarily was my practice of the law, and believe me, I never regretted my decision. I have recorded my experience in the Rajya Sabha in my autobiography, Before Memory Fades. This is not to ask you to buy the book. Don't buy it. I've got a copy of one of the chapters in Parliament and out of it, which I'll leave with the director here, and if you want copies, he'll send it to you without any payment. I mention this because I believe the chapter will help members of Parliament to understand not only the pleasures but also the problems and difficulties of a new entrant into Parliament. It is only when MPs constantly attend sessions in Parliament, even when they are sporadically adjourned from time to time, that a certain feeling of camaraderie develops amongst members belonging to different political parties. An MP builds up relationships with the person sitting next to him, or behind or in front of him or her, whatever his or her political affiliation. Besides, all the perks, the advantages, the free medical assistance during and even after an MP's tenure, the pension for life after retirement, must make you all realize. Although all Indians under our constitution are equal, Article 40, but some, like you, are definitely more equal than others. Definitely more equal than others. So, that's a great thing to remember that. Always remember that, for God's sake. Because it is something that ennobles you. And anything that ennobles you in life, I believe, is worth pursuing. This consciousness of an MP performing his or her duty, etc., must enter your consciousness, and this is really the work ethic. This was made apparent to one and all in the good old days, because there's this camaraderie I'm talking about, which is very, very important for you to know. When Pilu Modi, a very old and very good friend of ours, and he's no more, and Prime Minister Indira Gandhi were members in the 5th Lok Sabha, 71-77, they often crossed swords, but never lost their cool. Once in the house, on a matter of some importance, Pilu Modi wrote on parliamentary notepaper to the Prime Minister, expressing his concern about some particular measure or resolution that had just been adopted. And do you know how he began the letter? He began with, "Dear IG Indira Gandhi, dear IG," and he signed off with his own initials, PM. What cheek! But was Mrs. Gandhi affronted? Not on your life. Promptly came her reply, again on parliamentary notepaper. The contents are irrelevant. What counts is the spirit. She began her letter with, "Dear PM," signing off as IG. What could be greater? You see, that's the camaraderie that developed amongst people who are totally opposed to one another on the floor of the house. The two were the most astute political rivals, and yet they indulged in this light-hearted thrust and parry. So my point is, and I've experienced it myself, there's so much fun in Parliament. I've experienced a great deal of fun in Parliament. If you remain present throughout, there's a lot of fun. There's something to be gained. And I must tell you, this sense of fun, not merely humor, was instilled in me whenever I watched and listened to one of the great statesmen of his time, in my view, the greatest in Parliament, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, former Prime Minister. It is customary, and I'll tell you a story about him. It is customary that when a Prime Minister returns from a foreign visit, on his return, he has to make a statement in each of the House of Parliament if in session. And some MPs are handpicked by the chair and are asked to put questions, formal questions, to the Prime Minister. What did you do? Where did you go? What happened? Who did you speak to? Etc. So that further information can be elicited. On one such occasion, I, as a nominated member, was one of the fortunate few. Shekhawat was very good to me, to be so named by the chair. Shekhawat always told me that when you leave Parliament, you'll be the one who will be able to speak in Hindi. I'm sorry to have disappointed him. I couldn't speak in Hindi, even after I left Parliament. So on one occasion, I, along with two other members, were asked to ask some inane questions. One of the two gentlemen posed a question, I posed another, etc. But the third member of Parliament who was designated was a diplomat turned parliamentarian, Natwar Singh. Eloquent as always. He belonged to the Congress, which was then in opposition, and his questions were very critical of the government, full of invective as well. And Natwar Singh spoke in crisp English. He was very eloquent. "Mr. Chairman, sir," he said, "I have 6 questions for the Prime Minister." He just went on like that. There was Vajpayee sitting there in his chair where the Prime Minister sits. And he set them out one by one. While raising each question, he raised his voice as well, a decibel louder, and each time angrier than he had asked the previous question. And when Vajpayee got up to answer, ultimately came to the 6 questions posed by Natwar Singh, I was left wondering how he could deal with the pointed and inconvenient questions addressed to him. But the Prime Minister spoke, as he always did, in fluent Hindi, in response to the questions addressed to him in English. He said Natwar Singh was a great parliamentarian. He spoke in Hindi, of course. And that he, Vajpayee, had known him for many, many years. He said that the Congress MP was extremely intelligent and he knew all his facts. And then he added, Lekin unko gussa bahut jaldi aa jata hai. He gets angry very quickly. That riposte brought the whole house down. Everybody forgot the 6 questions of Natwar Singh, and that was the end. But see that man's statesman-like way of dealing with the problem. Atalji was the astute statesman to his fingertips, diplomatic when necessary, and he taught me a great lesson, actually. It's a lesson one learns, you know, when you get along and hear people who are greater than you, that it pays not to be angry or to lose your temper when speaking in Parliament. That's the worst thing that you can do. I've noticed nowadays when you people come on television, everybody gets very angry, very annoyed, and gets red. Not at all. Atalji was entirely different. You must learn from these people. There's something to be learned from them. It is always advisable to scotch your opponent with faint praise. This is one of the things I learnt in Parliament. Disarm your opponent, but never do it in anger or derision. Derision is also very bad. Never make fun of him. If you make fun of a person in Parliament, you make a mortal enemy of him. He'll be your enemy for life. You can't denigrate him. You have to pander him a bit. Professor Hiren Mukherjee, I had the great pleasure of listening to him years before I came to this house. He was continuously a member of 5 Lok Sabhas, from the very first 1952 up to 1977. Very fine human being. He has written a very inspiring memoir of his experiences titled Portrait of Parliament, Reflections and Recollections. He was a literator, probably Parliament's most eloquent member. I advise you all, if you can, get the book from the library and read it. The book is an eye-opener as to how proceedings in Parliament used to be conducted in those ancient days. He speaks of the camaraderie that is a necessary result of being together in Parliament. And he notes that he counts as his friends, members, not just of the CPI or CPIM, but also those belonging particularly to other parties. He declares that he was encouraged persistently and through quite critical periods of his life in Parliament by his old friend Dinesh Singh, Raja Dinesh Singh, and Shyam Nandan Mishra, stalwarts of the Congress Party in Parliament and once Central Minister. They were remote from him in political affiliation, but personally dear to him, and he then asserts this factor must not be considered to be strained. Hiren Mukherjee writes of his tenure in the first 5 Lok Sabhas, how with the 6th Lok Sabha, the ancient traditional Congress Party lost its ancient traditional and stupendous majority because and only because of that stupid experiment of the internal emergency, which became an excuse for excesses. But all this is a digression, which is a lawyer's bad habit. The main theme of this talk is the subject I was asked to speak on, but I believe in surprises. Is there any ethics? Just ask yourself this. Is there any ethics left in politics? The relevant question is, can there ever be ethics in politics? Perhaps there can, but never in party politics. There is no ethics in party politics. One of the great dilemmas of our democracy is that whilst political parties as a group have no need or no time for ethics because they are not expected to be ethical but only practical and pragmatic, individual members of Parliament have been provided with a code of ethics which they must observe, and you've got that whole list with you. We in the legal profession, and I'm giving you an example, have prescribed it is unethical for a lawyer not to accept a brief of a client, even if he or she considers the client to be a rogue and a scoundrel and regards his or her case as totally dishonest. Why? Professed reason is no human being accused of an offense or in need of a lawyer in a civil case can be denied legal assistance. That's our great excuse. The real reason, ladies and gentlemen, why this rule is framed is a selfish one, not at all based on ethics. It is to further the personal interest of the lawyer, that he or she must earn his fees, from whatever source, whatever his or her personal view about the case may be. Since he or she has no right to refuse the brief, he or she must accept it and, of course, appear in court, naturally not free, but for a fee, and generally a substantial fee, no matter what his or her views about the case have been. I have therefore come to believe that standards of how to conduct oneself in any collective form of activity, whilst it is a good thing, rules of conduct, if at all to be set out, need to be prescribed by those outside the fold, not by you, not by those within the fold. In other words, rules of ethics need to be framed not by MPs, but by those outside Parliament. In the interest of so-called party discipline, members of Parliament have to follow the party mandate, and neither their individual conscience nor their personal predilection as to what is right or wrong. In my view and in my experience, I must record, there are few instances of ethics in politics, but none in party politics. And let me give you some instances of ethics in politics. And great men, very few, have shown by example, not by precept, that doing the right moral thing at the right time is ethics in politics at its best. I offer you the following examples of three outstanding members of Parliament, all distinguished leaders, each of them proved that one can be ethical and act accordingly as an honourable member. First and foremost, I mention L.K. Advani. He was a great parliamentarian, eloquent both in Hindi and English. But more than that, when the Jain diaries surfaced in January 1996, where his name did not appear, but his initials did, with a large amount mentioned alongside, along with some other members of Parliament, and when he, along with others, was accused under the 1988 Prevention of Corruption Act, merely because their initials had so appeared, together with a cryptic figure in rupees, Advani did what every right-thinking person should do, but which no right-thinking person has done since then. He resigned his seat in Parliament in 1996 and publicly declared he would come back only when his name was clear. As he said, people vote for us and we have to live up to their trust. In my life, I have always listened to my conscience. That was what he said. Ultimately, after much trial and tribulation, his name as well as his conscience was cleared, first by the Delhi High Court in 1997, then by the Supreme Court in 1998. It was then that Advani re-entered Parliament in triumph. There is no law stating one must resign one's seat in Parliament when one is accused of an offence, even an offence of corruption. Nor is there anything in the Lok Sabha rule book or the Rajya Sabha rule book that says so. But Advani took it on himself to do the right thing. And doing the right thing in politics, a rare phenomenon, is not just ethics in politics, but heroics in politics. The second example, slightly different, and again exhibited by the most prominent parliamentarian of his time, the same Atalji. He had a very trusted, efficient and well-loved lieutenant in his Council of Ministers. But in July 2000, when that minister stepped out of his crease and made some intemperate remarks about the integrity of the then Chief Justice of India, about wrongly stating his date of birth. And then when this became public, you know what he did? He didn't ask his minister to resign. He went straight to the president and said, sack him. And he was sacked. He was sacked. Amazing. This. And he was very close to that gentleman. I know that personally. Very close. But he had him sacked. Because, why, he said? Because one constitutional authority cannot denigrate another constitutional authority. Simple. Whether you are right or wrong makes no difference. You have to live up to some ideal. This high moral sense of value exhibited by Vajpayee is what I would consider another great example of ethics in politics. And the third and the last example is that of distinguished former Speaker of the House, Somnath Chatterjee. When the Constitution came into effect in 1950, the first Speaker of the Lok Sabha, Mavlankar, staunch congressman, resigned from the party in the same hallowed tradition of British speakers. Namely, that when you become a speaker, you have to resign your party membership. But all the speakers that followed, 16 of them after him, never resigned their membership of their political party. And in keeping with this somewhat dubious long tradition, Somnath Chatterjee, when he was elected speaker in June 2004, continues as a member of the CPIM. But then the fact that he did not quit the CPIM was used by his own political party years later to embarrass him. And this happened in July 2008. The CPIM was then bitterly opposed to Dr. Manmohan Singh, Prime Minister, for initiating the nuclear deal with President Bush without parliamentary approval. And when Manmohan Singh decided to go ahead with the deal without parliamentary approval, the CPIM leadership decided to withdraw support to his government. The party then called upon Somnath Chatterjee to resign as Speaker and to vote against the confidence motion as he was still a member of the CPI. Chatterjee refused, saying, as Speaker, I cannot be dictated to by the party since I am expected to be neutral. After the confidence motion voted in the Lok Sabha and the UPA government survived, the CPI in July 2008 summarily expelled Somnath Chatterjee from his party membership. It was with a heavy heart that he then continued his post till May 2009, since he felt his expulsion as a party member was undue and unwarranted interference with his duties as a speaker, and morally he was right. I regret that I cannot offer any other notable example of ethics in politics, because I believe there are none. Let me end by asserting that members of parliament, individually and collectively, are not only privileged but, as I said, conferred with immense power. But all of you need to be reminded, and I'll end with this, with the famous Machiavellian question. It is one that you must be inspired with also. Niccolo Machiavelli, as you know, the chap who lived in the 16th century, an Italian known for his shrewd views on statecraft, he long ago asked the following question: how does one use power to do good if wielding power requires one to do evil? How does one use power to do good if wielding power requires one to do evil? And as good Indians, all you MPs can have only one answer to this Machiavellian question: that you will always use the power of your high office, it's a very high office, to do good, never to do evil. And I wish you good luck. Thank you.
Any clarification questions? I think none. Yeah, please.
Too long as it was. Sorry. We lawyers are very long-winded. We just go on.
Sir, I must congratulate, and I am very happy to hear you. I heard way back in Bangalore on budget session, on a budget of Karnataka, you spoke in Bangalore. I was your audience then, and I am very happy today as a member of parliament to hear you. Sir, you said the primary duty of a parliament member to not to disrupt the house. It is fine. But what is the other alternative for parliament members if the government is not sensitive to their demands?
Not sensitive?
Yes.
Make them more sensitive.
Sir.
Make them more sensitive.
It is easy to tell.
Persuasion.
The parliament members, apart from the party lines, they have joined together, pressed, pursued, and made lot of effort, government to be sensitive. When any government, X, Y, Z, I don't want to quote, if they are so insensitive, then what is the alternative? Yeah. And that is one thing, sir. Second.
Yes, sir.
See, the chair, with all respect to the chair, if the chair did not pursue the opposition and the ruling government and reconcile their problems, if they adjourn the house, what else the parliament members can do?
I quite agree with you on your second point, not the first. The second point is very important. Quite right. The chair has to remember that they have to hold the scales even.
Yes.
Chair must always remember. And the fact that the chair does not remember, and that often happens, I know that, it leads to a lot of distrust and disagreement. But on your first point, I only ask you to please consider, what would happen if I argued a case which I thought was absolutely cast iron before a constitution bench of the Supreme Court, and the judges said that no, it is all nonsense, we don't agree with you at all, it is all humbug. Am I supposed to shout at them? Am I supposed to bang my brief with them? So, you see, there are different methods of dealing with the same problem. I may be as angry as I like with them. There was once a senior counsel who, whenever he was angry with the judge, would turn to his junior and abuse him roundly, just for nothing, poor fellow, because he couldn't abuse the judge. So, I would advise you, quite frankly, that on your first point, you have to be extraordinarily careful. No government which is a majoritarian government is sensitive. Was the Congress government sensitive in the 70s, when it was in a total majority? It's the same here. Same. There's no difference. I find no difference at all. What is the difference? I'm neither BJP, nor am I Congress, nor am I JDU, I don't. But I'm just telling you, the problem with us is majoritarian government is to be watched very, very, very carefully. That's the problem, because a certain sense of arrogance builds up. It happened with the Congress government, it has happened with the present government. Also, I'm as critical of this government as I was of the previous government. In fact, I resigned during the emergency of the previous government. So, it is a matter of how you deal with it. There is no gainsaying this. Arrogance is something you cannot explain. It just is a force that you are now in charge. There's nobody who can oppose you. Anybody who opposes you is either tyrannical, or he's not a patriot, or he's not this, or he's not that. You see, all that is a lot of foolish nonsense. I don't believe in that at all. But you have to be persuasive. There's no other way, because Parliament is on persuasion. What other way is there? I find no other way. See, I was very disturbed, as you must have been, when the present Turkish president was re-elected, and with a tremendous majority, 82%, of people voting in his favor, despite everything that he did. And ultimately, when he came on television, he was full of arrogance. Full of arrogance. Because it goes to your head, you can't help it. You require some factor to bring your thing down, because it's impossible. You say, the people are with me, the people are with me, the people are with me. But who knows whether the people are with you or without you, they're not with you. So these are things which are very, very troublesome, very troublesome. But you cannot do it with anger, please. Don't do it with anger. And Vajpayee is your best bet. To my mind, he had that remarkable quality where he could reduce you to explain everything that he could, but he did it with sophistication. And if you do it with sophistication, nobody bothers. If you do it with pressure, with such, people get very upset. That's all. Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you, Nariman sir, for your excellent, effective and interesting presentation. Before you leave, may I request Secretary General Rajya Sabha to present a memento to you on behalf of all the participating members.
Thank you. Thank
you. So, fantastic.
So nice of you.
We wanted to hear you more and more.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, and good luck to all of you. You need a lot of luck. Thank you, Minister, for being present. Good.
आप देख रहे थे संसद परिसर में राज्यसभा के नए सांसदों के लिए आयोजित दो दिन का विषय बोध यानी कि ओरिएंटेशन कार्यक्रम। कार्यक्रम में पूर्व राज्यसभा सांसद और जाने माने कानूनविद फाली एस नारीमन ने सांसदों को राजनीति में आचार संहिता के महत्व के बारे में बताया। इससे पहले बीजेपी सांसद भूपेंद्र यादव ने लोक महत्व के मुद्दों पर जानकारी दी। वहीं एनसीपी सांसद माजिद मेनन ने नए सांसदों को कानून बनने की पूरी प्रक्रिया समझाई और संसद में कानून बनाने के हर पहलू पर विस्तार से प्रकाश डाला। आपको बता दें कि दो दिन तक चलने वाले ओरिएंटेशन कार्यक्रम का आज आखिरी दिन है। संसद परिसर में हो रहे इस कार्यक्रम का उपराष्ट्रपति और राज्यसभा के सभापति एम वेंकैया नायडू ने शनिवार को शुभारंभ किया था। इसी के साथ यहां रुकेंगे एक ब्रेक के लिए।